And thanks for being here. I'm Julie Philipp. A year ago at this time, the Rochester City School District was looking at a budget proposal that cut more than 500 teaching positions. The district and unions were arguing over the size of the budget deficit, which some said was close to $76 million. Teachers, parents, and students were rallying, fearing some music and art programs were being gutted in the process. Fast forward to today, and the picture is a lot different. This week's Rochester Interim City School Superintendent, Dr. Bolgen Vargas, released his first budget proposal. I've invited Dr. Vargas and Rochester Teachers Association President Adam Urbanski here to talk about it. Welcome, both of you. Thank you for coming in. You proposed a $704 million spending plan this week. It's kind of hard for people to understand how we can go from last year and the year before to what seems to be a much warmer climate this year. I'm going to ask you both to offer your explanation as to what's creating this global warming, if you will.
Well, number one is driven by the needs of our students. We can no longer operate an educational system that doesn't offer art, music, sport to our children. And so to me, a budget is a statement of our values and our priorities. And one explanation why the increase, number one, because we did receive some increase from the state education, from New York mm-hmm. State. And second, we did carefully went through the budget line by line, and we found some significant efficiency in the budget. So that allowed us to shift the resources to what needed the most.
Okay, I want to get into what those efficiencies are a bit in a minute, but first I want to hear your explanation for just an easier budget year all around.
Well, the budget, any public budget, any organizational budget, even personal budgets, is a matter of choices. We have, for example, in the city school district, about $700 million to spend no matter what choices we make. I have to say that this is probably the most commonsensical budget I've seen in 30 years in the Rochester City School District, because what it does essentially is it staffs the classrooms in the schools first and then looks to see how much is left for peripheral things or less things that less directly affect children. And it's also a smart budget because we used to actually make very bad use of some of the money that we had, and now we make better use of it. For example, one thing that Superintendent Vargas added to the budget is that instead of laying off a lot of teachers in June and then rehiring them in September, and in between paying for unemployment insurance, he said, why don't we take that money that we're paying for unemployment insurance and actually avoid the layoffs? That's actually a savings not only for the district but for the taxpayers, and I think that was very smart.
So is that an example of one of the efficiencies you found then? Efficiency sounds like a great word. You've used it a lot this year, but very few details around this.
Actually, let me give you a specific detail mm-hmm. around unemployment. The culture of the district is one that during June, we let go a lot of teachers, and then we bring them back on September. As a result, we end up losing teachers because some of the teachers, they go and work elsewhere. Mm-hmm. But number two, we also pay a lot on unemployment benefit. Last year, for example, in this year's budget, I'm talking about 2011-2012, we projected to spend over $4 million on unemployment. I'm here to say to you that is my goal that in the 2012-2013 budget, we will spend less than half a million. That is a clear example of efficiency. The other area that I did look at is area of consulting. Obviously, and I don't have anything against consulting, but what do I get? A classroom teacher for our children? Or do I hire a consultant to advise us on various topics?
Let me mention one other efficiency that I noticed in the budget. We are saving, I think, approximately $1.5 million on health benefits because the district did a survey to see if we're paying out some money that we need not pay out. In other words, we corrected our data and our records, and now less money is being spent on health benefits. That's another million and a half.
You know,
that's quite a few teachers.
Where was the money going?
Let me
go ahead. Go ahead.
Actually, I want to thank all the union leaders, because when I came in I said, let's have a conversation about health care. And what we agreed to do was to do an audit to make sure that the people that are working in the district are receiving the benefit that we owe to them. However, if you don't keep your record, your data clearly, there are times that people leave and we continue to pay health care benefit.
Or premiums.
Mm-hmm. And what we're finding is, for example, already 178 people were in our health insurance when they shouldn't have been. So that's another example of phishing, but it requires collaboration because it's a very intrusive process that we went through in terms of asking people for record, for information, but it's something that is standard procedure in when you're talking about running an organization in a very efficient way.
Now that sounds like really bad management if people are, you know, several hundred people that you found are collecting benefits that they're no longer entitled to. At the same time, you're keeping cuts away from the classroom, but you're cutting from central administration where the records are kept. Is that going to create further problems down the road?
Absolutely no. This budget includes resources to strengthening our data system. Interesting that you pointed that out. You cannot afford to run a system where the data is not doesn't have the highest integrity. And I found a little bit of problem in our data system that we are working very diligent to make sure that we're strengthening that. Actually, I'm one who believe that we can make significant improvement in terms of our managing system if we all work very hard at it, because it's a priority of mine, because we can no longer afford, particularly during this financial time, which is a very challenge, not to look for efficiency everywhere. And in order to do that, you need good data.
Mm-hmm. You do have a deficit to deal with, though, as you're increasing the budget. $44 million, I believe, is a deficit you're closing. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Talk about how a large part of that due to contractual salary increases, benefits, that sort of thing. How are you offsetting that? You said, first of all, there's an increase in state aid.
In three ways. We got $18 million from New York State.
$18 million more, right?
Yep, $18 million more, mm-hmm. additional dollars. And we also, summer, we made a very important choice, and that was to put money in our reserve rather than spend it, although we were facing significant challenge. And out of that, we are using $15 million, and then the rest came through efficiency, around $14 million.
The reserves have been dipped into the past. A couple of years ago, I think it was close to $25 million. Former Superintendent Brizard last year indicated that the reserves were pretty low, the undesignated portion of it. Are you concerned that dipping into it again is going to leave you in a bad spot in future years?
All things being equal, I'd be concerned. However, we are building the reserve. As it is today, we had a $26 million in reserve. And we only are using 15. And by the time we close this year, because I'm putting some serious step in place, like travel and consulting, and every dollar that we are spending very carefully. And part of that is to make sure that we build our reserve. As I'm saying to you today, we have an $11 million available to us in our reserve fund.
And how much of that is undesignated? What portion of that percentage?
Right now, in terms of it would be available, it's not designated to anything right now. But if we were to have a crisis situation, then we would have to tap onto that. But let me just say this. For next year, our gap for 2013-2014 mm-hmm. Is 33 million. So that is significantly less than this current challenge that we are facing. I am confident that we can manage that next year through various ways. One way is that we need to continue to work on our efficiency. We are not close to where we need to be. We need to make more improvement in that area, and I'm confident that we can do that.
Some of the money coming into the district is tied to teacher accountability and evaluation measures. Can you talk about where those stand, what changes are being made in the upcoming school year?
Well, I think we've done better than most school districts in the state on that front. Money came from what used to be called No Child Left Behind, now it's called Race to the Top. And from the and it's passed, most of that federal money combined with state money is passed through the state. Mm-hmm. And there were opportunities here to improve the teacher evaluation system and the administrator evaluation system, and to improve how we change our schools that are struggling, and some incentive money to improve the knowledge and skills of teachers. We were able to come to an agreement with the district on every one of those opportunities. I think we're one of very few, a handful of districts in New York State who could do that. So it's more money for the district, which now the district is putting to, I think, very wise use. But it's also a way to improve both the practice of teaching to support teachers. A lot of the money went for professional development. These are not punitive measures. These are measures that help to strengthen the skills of teachers and to bring about really good active models for teaching and learning at the school level, so that kids would have project-based learning rather than just listening to someone talk, that they would have performance-based assessments rather than just guessing or multiple choice. I'm very happy, I don't know about the superintendent, but I'm very happy with how this turned out, how it helped the district and our children.
Absolutely, we are very proud because we were the first in New York State to come out with such an agreement. That's why we are now facing the challenge, and if you look to the west of us in Buffalo,
Buffalo didn't get the money.
And they didn't get the money and it's still struggling. So once again, those is what I call it, evidence or collaboration, because you don't just want to collaborate for collaboration's sake, but mm-hmm. where's the evidence? And through the ITA and the administrator union as well, we have been able to make significant gain as far as the principal teacher evaluation.
What's not in this budget, though, is something you brought up in your State of the Schools address about extending the school day, extending the school year. You indicated that that's really more time on task mm-hmm. is really the key to improving student performance.
Absolutely. Time on task is essential. We need to give our students more time. And yes, in this budget, I have $300,000 in it for East High School in Monroe to improve the graduation rate in there. One way to improve graduation is when a child falls behind, let's say in English or math or science or any subject, is that we immediately provide the support that they need to catch up. And actually, I'm one who believes that we are not going to significantly improve the educational achievement of our children unless we provide the support, on-time support. We can't wait. We have to be proactive rather than reactive when it comes to intervention. And part of that, we require for some of our students that we extend the school day, and in many cases, the school year.
So is that tutoring help, or you're actually, so you wouldn't extend the school day through a whole school, it would just be kids that were falling behind?
Actually, that would be a desire of mine, and I will go to the State Education Department. Formal, for example, have put some money aside for competitor grant. And there are some of our school, for example, I have a significant number of school that the entire student body is in such a need of support, academic support, social and emotional, that it will require for us to enter into an agreement with ITA and other and make sure that our school provide more time to provide students with academic intervention, social and emotional support. And I hope that it will be well received by the State Ed Department.
Yeah, in fact, a report came out Thursday saying only about a third, a little over a third of city schools are meeting state expectations and standards. He says he wants to enter into negotiations with the union to extend the day, extend the school year. Where does that stand, and what's your stance on it?
I think it's largely doable. Fortunately, not all children need additional time. As a matter of fact, one could argue that in high schools, some children need less time because they're more quickly ready to fulfill all the requirements and should probably be allowed to take courses at the college level and so forth. So because not all children need additional time, I think it could be affordable to extend either the school day or the school year, but we want to do it in a targeted way. We don't want to spend scarce resources where they are not so much needed. But yes, the labor management collaboration that Dr. Vargas referred to makes virtually everything possible as long as the district treats its teachers as partners, as long as the district doesn't blame the teachers but rather supports the teachers, then there is no limit on what we could do to depart from past practices and to adopt more practices that would help our students to succeed.
So it sounds like you have not really gone down that road yet. It's in the works. Do you see something happening this year, or something like an extended school day would be perhaps in next year's budget?
Well, there will be some. Actually, I'm using the Title I money already.
For the pilot programs, in
a limited basis. And I think what Dr. Urbanski is saying is extremely important to pay attention. That is that not all our children need extra time. But we do have a significant number of them that could benefit from it.
And we have also jointly approached some major foundations in this country to invest in a pilot program here in Rochester to make it more affordable, to extend learning time, and to make learning time more flexible for as many children as needed. And those conversations are pretty encouraging. So we're hoping that between public money and private foundations, we may be able to do something even as early as the next school year.
So there's will, just teachers want to get paid, and you have to find the money, basically.
We have to find the resources, and we will, because I have said that, you know, for the past 10 years, we have been engaged in educational reform from the top down, all the way from Washington to Rochester. And I think those of us, when I talk to teachers, they will tell you that our children need more social-emotional support and that they need academic support. Because when they arrive into the classroom, they are behind. So common sense will tell you that for those children that are coming to a school behind, that we're going to have to provide them with some extra time and extra support. Now, extra time alone is not what it's going to do. It's going to be the teacher, it's going to be the social-emotional support, it's going to be the academic, and social development for a kid that I think will get us there.
Okay, we only have about a minute left, and I want to get to one more thing before I let you go. You're indicating that the through attrition and other things, there will be no layoffs. The staff salary, there might be a reduction in staff through attrition, but at this point, you're hoping not to lay off anyone. Does that include, you're closing a school, though, school six. Yeah. Will those teachers then find other places
Absolutely, yes. Those teachers would be we'll be going to other schools. It's important that you mention that because through closing school six, we were able to save $2.6 million. So that have allowed us, because we had declining enrollment, it allowed us to make the adjustment and also save some dollars that are much needed. And, you know, by closing school number six, no one wants to close the school. I'm the first one to tell you that is a very difficult thing to do. And it's something that you only do if you have to. In our case, we have a significant...
The population is declining.
Population is declining,
year.
So it's called for adjustment in our space. Mm-hmm. And our use
but
of
the
our
teachers
schools.
Are going to have jobs still.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Teachers.
No teacher... my goal is, because of what we went through last year, You know, you had a mass number mm-hmm. of layoffs. I'm talking about hundreds of teachers and paraprofessionals and others were laid off, that this community cannot afford it to continue.
Okay, we're out of time, and thank you so much. We obviously could spend much more time together on this, and I appreciate you coming in.
Well, thank you.
Dr. Bolgen Vargas, Interim Superintendent of the Rochester City School District, and Dr. Adam Urbanski, who is President of the Rochester Teachers Association.